you're the one who always saves the day, Jesus. You never let me down, no. There's no place for fear, no place for worry. I stand in your confidence and I know you're the one who has me, who holds me. You go before me, you prepare the way in front of me, Jesus, guiding every step along the way. You're the one who goes before me, you're the one who stands behind me, you're the one that's all around me, surrounding me, Jesus. I know I can trust you, Jesus, yeah. Before me, behind me, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me. Oh, I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, no Fire that rules.
morning. We're going to open up in prayer so we can get started here. Thank you, Lord. Father, once again, we're just so grateful to be in your house this morning, Lord. We just pray, Father, that as we worship and we just give you honor and glory, Father, that you are so worthy of. And we just ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Oh, some people are still asleep. Good morning.
Good morning. Morning.
I hope everybody's having a good morning. I know I am. Whew. So let's get ready to worship the Lord. Amen.
Of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me, and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise, death is defeated, the King is alive. Everything inside of me, I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hold on me, and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise, death is defeated, the King is alive. A little louder. singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down flights till I'm found, leaves the 99. Oh, how could it earn it? I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Yeah.
from the first break of light to last days, every echo of time, every evening fade. You've always been there. From a baby's first cry every fight in our minds, every victory dance, you've always been there. Ancient one, so alive.
Glory be to God. I don't know about you, but I'm just feeling the presence of the Lord. How many of you are grateful that God is in this place, that God is in your life, and that he's with you, and he's never left you, he's never going to leave you, he's never going to forsake you, and whatever you're going through today, whatever seems is going in your life today, God is bigger than it. Amen? Put it in his hands and let it go, or call it down. Speak to the mountain. Amen? Oh, thank you, Lord. I just feel like right now we should just take 30 seconds. Just take 30 seconds. Say whatever you want to say to the Lord. Thank him. Just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your greatness. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We're just overwhelmed, Father, with your love and your presence in our lives, Father. Thank you, Lord. You're a great Father. Father, you're a good Father. We're overwhelmed with your presence, Father. We honor you this morning. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We're overwhelmed with your goodness, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We want to continue in that attitude of praise to our Father, amen. We want to honor him and glorify him with our tithes and our offerings. And this morning I want to read in Philippians chapter 4, verse 15-17. And it says, Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. Not that I seek the give, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Amen. Vision Church, brothers and sisters, is good ground. And I've heard so many testimonies as when people have brought their tithes and offering to this place, and all the testimonies of all the great things that have happened to them. And I get, me and my husband, we get overjoyed, and because we seek the fruit that abounds to your account. We like to hear that the Lord is blessing you, and we preach tithes and offering because we believe in that, and we believe that there's a great blessing in that, and it gives us joy in our heart when we hear people prospering, when we hear people. To me, the greatest thing is when someone comes in and tells me, you know what, I could never afford a house, but now the Lord has provided a house for us, and they've bought a house. That's something to rejoice about to me. You know, we're always praying for that, you know, that people would have houses that are paid. Amen. And so it gives us great joy. We've heard a brother here, you know, that when he started coming here and he started tithing and giving, and the Lord blessed him, his house is paid, his cars are paid, and he says, I'm not making any more, but my money, what I have left over is multiplying. Praise God. That's a great testimony, right? My parents are here, and I help them with their finances, write out their bills and stuff. And they're on Social Security, and I see how the Lord's multiplying their tithers and givers. And man, they're blessed with what little Social Security they get. But that's not because of what they're getting. It's because God's our provider. He's providing. You're faithful to this word. You give. And he's going to give into you, right? It's a principle of sowing and reaping. Amen? A spiritual principle. And so we want to honor the Lord this morning with our tithes and our offering. And expect. There's nothing wrong in expecting God to be good to you. Because he's looking for people that are expecting good things from him. Right? It's just like our kids. They expect us to feed them, to clothe them. They expect us to be nice to them when they ask us for something, right? And so the Lord, you know, sometimes you just hear your child has a need. They might not ask you for it, but you want to help them because they're your child. And so you give unto them, right? The Lord's the same way. He knows our needs. And sometimes we could just say, Lord, you know, this is what I need. This is my need. He knows it, but you ask of it. You show your faith. You give in faith, and the Lord's going to provide for you. Amen? And he's going to honor you as we honor him. Amen? So prepare your tithes and offering. You want to bring them on up, and then I will pray over them. If you're giving online, you can give online at vclockhart.com. Go to the giving tab and just follow the prompts, and you'll get to give online. Some people are mailing them in. So if you want to mail it in, you can go. It's P.O. Box 1399, Lockhart, Texas, 78644. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning, Father. I thank you for my brothers and sisters, Lord, and those giving online, Father, to Vision Church of Lockhart, Father. I thank you that this place is good ground, Father. We're preaching your word and teaching your word, Father, building up disciples, Father, building up strong Christians, Father, that they would go out and do the work of the ministry, Father, wherever we are, everyone equipped, Father, to reach out to those around them, Father, to reach the people that are in their sphere of influence, that they influence, Father. Father, I thank you for their jobs, for their retirement funds, for clients, customers, businesses, Father. I just pray, Father, that your favor would be upon each one of them, Father. I thank you, Lord, that your word says that you shall supply all their needs according to the riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And I confess that over my brothers and sisters this morning, Father, that they would have a revelation, Father, of kingdom giving, Father. That we give, Father, so we can reach others for Christ, Father. And we have to be about it speedily, Father, because you're a soon coming King. And we just give you honor and glory with these tithes and offering. Bless it, multiply it. Give the stewards that are over it, Father, wisdom to use this money, Father, in the name of Jesus, and that you would be glorified for every decision that we make. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you, Lord.
All right. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see everybody this morning. Who's happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. All right. We're going to get started with our announcements real quick. We have a few announcements here. Remember, you can always visit us on website, vclockhart.com, for all our services on YouTube and Facebook. And then we have our guidelines that we follow here in the church. One, every other row will be blocked off. Two, families must sit two chairs apart from each other. Families. Three, practice social distancing. Four, feel free to wear a mask or gloves if you want to. And five, once again, we always encourage if you're not feeling good to stay home and let us know. We'll pray for you. And then last but not least, to always remember you can join us online for our Wednesday services at 7 p.m. or you can come here and join us, which would be even better. We are studying how to become a water walker in English and in Spanish. And that's it. So everybody happy? Everybody excited? We're going to get a good word from Pastor this morning. So everybody enjoy the service.
Praise the Lord. It is good to be with you all this morning, to see all your smiling faces. Man, worship was powerful, wasn't it? I'm going to say something that Andrew Womack says, and I kind of like this saying. Man, if that doesn't light your fire, your wood is wet. Amen. I love that saying. So, you know, I'll tell you, God wants to experience us every day, not just at church. Amen? And our experiences at church would be much more powerful if we were fellowshipping with him on a daily basis at home. I mean, the problem is that we are carnal all week, and then we come to church, and all of a sudden we try to get all spiritual in 2 hours, you know? And we try to make up for lost time for those, you know, 6 days that we were being carnal. And I'll tell you, God loves you whether you're carnal or spiritual, but I'm just going to tell you right now, the spiritual life is better. Amen? Amen? The spiritual life is life and peace. The spiritual life is being confident in your relationship with God, knowing that he loves you, knowing that he accepts you, knowing that you are his beloved, that you are born again, that you are filled with the Spirit of God, that no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. This is what it means to be spiritually minded. Amen? Praise God. So let's get in the Spirit on a daily basis. Let's fellowship with our God. He's wanting to talk to us every day. Those things you're stressing about, those things you're worrying about, those things you have questions about, man, if you would just seek the face of God, you wouldn't have to try so hard to figure things out. Amen? You know why? Because God is light. The Bible says in him is no darkness at all. Guess what happens in light? All things are revealed for what they truly are. You'll know the right path to take. You won't question yourself. But brothers and sisters, we have got to be fellowshipping with God. We've got to be fellowshipping and abiding in the light. Amen? Thank you, Lord. That's not the message today, but you know what? That's a good precursor to the message, isn't it? Praise God. We ought to be excited about what Jesus has done in us and what he wants to continue to do in us. So this morning, the title of today's message is The Meaning of Life. The Meaning of Life. And how many of you know it is so important that we live life with purpose? It is so important that we understand that our life has meaning. I don't care if you're 2 years old or if you're 90 years old. Your life has meaning. I don't care if you have messed up tremendously. I don't care if... Thank you, Lord. I don't care if your life has messed up tremendously. I don't care if you feel like you're at the bottom of the barrel. I don't care if you feel like you've made a million mistakes. Praise God. God has a plan for your life. There is meaning in your life. And this is what I love about God, is God never gives up. His fire is never extinguished. And when I say his fire, I mean God's passion for you. The calling of God is the gifts of God. They're without repentance. Amen. God doesn't take meaning from your life when you disappoint him or when you fail him or anything like that. Amen. God loves you, and his fire is always burning brightly. His passion for you, his love for you, to see you succeed, to see you do well, to see you prosper in life, to see you prosper and be in health in your body, and to have enough finances to take care of your family and to be a blessing to other people. God wants to bless our households. He is passionate about us. I'm telling you this morning, whether you're here or whether you're watching online, God loves you. Amen? He is passionate about you, and you have meaning in your life. It is God's love and God's love alone that gives us meaning in our life. The Bible says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Amen? That ought to give us some great hope right there. So let's go ahead and pray, and we're going to jump in this morning. Father God, we just thank you so much for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. You are good. And because you are good, Lord, we know that we can always count on you. We can trust in you. We can believe in you with all of our heart, God, because you are a rewarder of those who diligently seek you. And we seek your face this morning, God. We will seek your face tomorrow and the day after, because you are good. And you're going to show yourself to us in ways, Lord, that we have not seen, that we have not experienced before, because that's the kind of God that you are. There are things about you, God, that we have not seen yet. But, Lord, that's why we keep pursuing you, because we thank you that the more we seek you, the more that we see, the more we find you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's go over here to John 17:3. John chapter 17 and verse 3. And by the way, I hope our online audience is enjoying our new camera and system we have set up. Maybe later on you guys can go check it out. Our live stream is much better quality now. So thank God that He's provided for us. And I want to thank those of you, you know, who give in this church and who help us to, make these things possible to be a blessing to those who can't physically be in church right now, right? So praise God for that. Thank you, Lord. All right, so here in John chapter 17 and verse 3, the meaning of life, and this is eternal life. Let me ask you this. Isn't eternal life the end goal here? Isn't that what we're living for? Right? I mean, the Bible says, you know, your life is not in vain. The good things you do on earth, God says, I will reward you for those good things. Here on earth and also there in heaven. Eternal life is the end goal. That's what we're all living for. If you're not living for eternal life, then you're living your life in vain. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later. But eternal life, brothers and sisters, is everything. I mean, this life is it's here, then it's gone. Right? Our life is like a vapor. So eternal life is everything. And this is what Jesus is saying eternal life is. That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. That they may know you. Isn't that so simple? We try to complicate things and we're like, well, I got to get this in order. I got to get that in order. And we try to complicate the spiritual life. No wonder it's so hard for people to be Christians. Because they feel like, you know, they feel like they always have this burden on them. They always need to be different. They always need to change. They always need to fix something. And sometimes we get in this mentality of trying to correct and fix everything. Right? We get in that sinkhole of just always trying to fix everything. But God says, you know, the one really important thing in life, this is eternal life. This is what your life is all about. This is what the main focus of your life should be. This is what you should be thinking about, living for, breathing for every day, all day. Eternal life is knowing God. Knowing God. It's a very simple concept, but, you know, it's amazing how many people that you can talk to and you see out there, you know, on the news or whatever, and you can tell they don't know God. And how do we know that? By the way they talk. We know that by their behavior. Because if they had met God, and if they knew God, their lives would be changed. Changed by the power of His grace. Amen? I got to slow down here. My voice is... Thank you, Lord. But I'll tell you, God wants us to know Him. How simple is that? Thank you, Lord. All the time we spend with our energy doing this and doing that and going here and going there, and we forget the one thing, that eternal life is this, to know Him. How many of us are making that our number one goal every day we wake up? To know Him more than the day before. To have Him reveal Himself to us more than the week before. Amen? I don't know about you, but, you know, if you follow the rules of religion, which this is not about a religion, this is about a relationship with God. This is about fellowshipping with God. That's what it means to know God. You can't know God through religion. You can know rules, and you can know, you know, you can know spiritual things about, or rules about trying to be spiritual and things like that, but you can't know God. That doesn't get you closer to God. Following rules doesn't get you closer to God. Amen? Only faith does. And we're going to see that a little bit later too, but I'm telling you, the number one thing is to know Him. Now, I want to ask you this question. Why would we want to know Him? Why would we want to know God? You know, when you want to get to know someone, it's because you like them, right? I spent like 5 minutes with them. I spent 30 minutes or an hour with them. I like them. I'm attracted to them. I want to get to know them more. They seem like a good person. They seem like a funny person. They seem like they have a good personality. They seem like something that would be cool to hang out with. You know, I want to get to know them more. And I'll tell you, the thing about God is that once you try Him, right, just like in, you know, He tells us in the Word, He says, try me now in this. Once you try God, man, you're hooked. Once you get a little taste, of God's goodness, a little taste of God's glory, a little taste of his love, a little taste of purpose, a little taste of peace, you're hooked. Because it's not religion, it's knowing him. It's fellowshipping with him. Amen? Religion, excuse me, you get burned out quickly in religion. You do. Because religion is not about really knowing God. And there are so many different sides to God. Not that God is different. That's not what I mean. I just mean God is so, there is so much depth to him. There is so much width to the person and being of God. You cannot exhaust knowing him. Your knowledge of him, you cannot exhaust that. I don't care how long you seek God for, how much you seek to know him. You cannot say, oh, I know everything there is to know about God. I've experienced everything there is to experience about the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, I don't care if you've been in church for an hour. I don't care if it's for your first time in church. I don't care if you've been in church for 40, 50 years. There is more for you to know. There is more for you to find. You know, the Bible didn't say to when he says, you know, to ask and you'll receive and seek and you'll find and knock and the door will be open to you. He didn't say, you know, seek and you'll find until you've been in church about 50 years and then you don't need to seek no more. I'm telling y'all that you got to press in. And you can't do that through religion. You got to do that through a relationship with God, to know him. This is eternal life. This is the meaning of life, to know him. Amen? And when you get to that point to where you know him so much, you lose yourself. When you are seeking God with all that you are, you lose sight of yourself. You lose yourself in that conquest, in that adventure. Or you get lost in him. Amen? And it's not about us. And it no longer becomes about you and your feelings and your emotions. And you no longer break down the way you used to. And you're no longer, you know, angry and depressed the way you used to be and harboring unforgiveness in your heart the way you used to. Why? Because you are so lost in him that you are just dead to those things. You're just dull to those things. Now, don't get me wrong, we have flesh. And that flesh isn't going away anytime soon. Amen? As long as you are on this earth, you will have flesh, and you will have temptation, and you will have things that you're going to have to deal with, feelings and emotions that you're going to have to deal with. But when you are seeking God to know him, I'll tell you, like I said, those things, they just get put on the back burner. When you are seeking him with all of your heart, you know, I think David said as a deer, you know, thirst for water, so my heart, you know, thirst or pants after God. Amen? I mean, you don't have time for these things. I got to know God. I don't have time to waste 30 years of my life being, you know, depressed or bitter or down. I don't have time for that. Why? Because I'm seeking to know him. Amen? This is eternal life. Now, again, why would we want to know God? Well, let's go over here to John 14:6. The better question is, why wouldn't you want to know God? But the question I'm posing to you today is John 14:6. Why would we want to know God? So let's read that here. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Except through me. So this is here Jesus describing himself, saying, I am the way. Somebody say, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Man, we got to say that with some strength, amen? We got to say that with some conviction, because the world needs to know, and they need to hear, that Jesus And Jesus alone is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. Thank you, Lord. So, this is who he is. This is who we are getting to know. Amen. Now, we see in John chapter 8 and verse 32, the Bible says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." So when Jesus says, "I am the truth," what he's telling you is that I am your key to freedom. I am your ticket to freedom. Not just freedom physically. I'm talking about freedom in your soul. Because there's nothing worse than being free in the outside world and being a prison in your own soul. He says, "I'm here to set you free. I'm here to be your freedom from physical oppression, from sickness and disease. I'm here to be your freedom." Anybody who has been sick with a debilitating sickness knows you're not free when you're going through something like that. Amen? You're imprisoned to whatever that thing is that's attacking you. And I'm here to tell you that God wants you free from all oppression. Jesus is your healing. He is the love that heals your heart. Amen? He is the key that opens up the gates to freedom in your life. He is the truth, and therefore he is our freedom. John 8:36, let's go over there. John 8:36. I love this here. "Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed." If the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I love that he has to emphasize that. You're not just free, you're free indeed. Amen. How many of you know that Satan likes to deceive people? Right? That's why sin is tempting. It's tempting because you're deceived. You think it's going to bring you something that when you give in to that temptation, you find out, well, man, that was a false promise. It didn't give me what I thought it'd give me. Right? Satan is the deceiver. He is the father of lies, as Jesus calls him. And how many of you know that the enemy offers, he always tries to imitate God. You know? Like when you see, you know, this came to me, you see a bunch of Louis Vuitton purses out there, and you're like, that's not real, that's not Louis Vuitton. You know, you see somebody with a Louis Vuitton purse, you're like, I know they ain't got the money to buy a Louis Vuitton. That's just a knockoff. I don't care how many LVs you put on there, that is not a Louis Vuitton. Amen. That's what Satan is. He's a knockoff of the good thing, of the real thing that God offers us. Amen. Everything Satan does, it's all temporary. It's all temporary. Amen. So, you know, the enemy, he offers us a false sense of freedom, doesn't he? A false sense of freedom. And you know, I mean, we see that around us right now. We got a lot of different people in cities trying to defund the police. And their idea of freedom is, no authority. That's really what they want, just no authority, you know? And that's their sense of freedom. That's not freedom. Have you seen the cities that are trying to defund the police? You got killings and murders going up 100, 200%. You got all kinds of buildings being set on fire and looting, and that does not look like freedom to me. But people, you know, they have this, when you're without God, I mean, you're deceived. And in their minds, you know, true freedom is no authority. You know, that's why they're against, you know, that's why socialism is on the rise today that we see. People don't want authority in their life. You know? They're against the owners. It's like, man, those owners took a great risk. A great risk. They used their brilliance, their innovation, to produce your job. The job you work at is thanks to them. Because God knows you would never have thought of what they did. Amen? So, I'm just saying, you know, the reason socialism is on the rise is because people are, they're deceived by this false sense of freedom, no authority, no authority. It's a rebellious generation that is calling for socialism. You understand? It's not a God-fearing generation that's calling for socialism. Amen. This is, so, you know, the enemy offers people a false sense of freedom, and they really truly believe these things are good for society. These things are going to help. But man, they don't know. They don't know. You know, socialism, communism, how many millions and millions and millions have died in Russia and China and others for the fight of communism and socialism? That is not freedom. You know what that is? That's the enemy. That is darkness. That's what that is. You know, Satan is involved. I don't know if you guys knew this, but Satan is involved in the political arena. Did you all know that? Christians like to act like, you know, the politics, that's not for me. What, you think Jesus is drawing a line at politics? I mean, not Jesus, you know, Satan? You think Satan is drawing a line at politics? Satan's like, oh, they're the governor, they're the mayor, they're the, you know, council in the city, they're the president, they're whatever, I'm just going to leave them alone. Satan doesn't get involved in politics. Jesus called us to shine our light in every part of the world. So when we see something that may sound good to a lot of people, but we know what it leads to, we know the evil and darkness it brings, it is our responsibility as the light of the world to speak up. Amen? Speak up for the truth. Because Satan is desiring to kill and torture and steal from so many people that he has deceived into believing this lie, that socialism is good for America. I'm telling you, we are the light of the world, brothers and sisters. And we got to take this responsibility seriously. We are ambassadors for Christ. Amen? We've got to view things not from a natural perspective. We're not fighting against man, but we got to view things from a spiritual perspective. This is darkness and light fighting. Amen? Fighting Satan is definitely fighting for the many souls in America. Amen. So God is calling us to be his ambassadors and fight back. Amen? So the enemy, again, he offers a lot of people this false sense of freedom, false sense of security, but God gives us the real thing. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And I wrote it down here, and I think this is so important. Apart from Christ, apart from knowing him, you don't even know what real freedom looks or feels like. Amen? And that's why those of us who have tasted and seen the goodness of God, who know what real freedom is, man, we've got to get serious about knowing God. Because the more you know God, the more you exude who he is to others. I mean, it's just the atmosphere you create around you, the environment you create around you, one of love, one of faith, one of peace, tranquility, meaning and purpose. That's going to rub off on other people. And the world needs to see what true and real freedom looks like. I believe that's why the world is trying to find so many different avenues to freedom, is because the Christians are not shining their light and showing them Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And there will be, you know, the world, many in the world, most in the world will reject Christ. But that's not our concern. There are many people in the world, the harvest is ripe, but we just need to shine our light. Amen? We just need to shine our light for them. Thank you, Jesus. So I want us to go over here to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 16. Genesis 2:16. So he's the truth, and Jesus is also the life. The life. How many of you want to live? Truly live. Not survive. There's a difference between surviving and living. You understand? I want to live. Amen. What is living? Well, eternal life. To know him. So here in Genesis chapter 2, verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. That sounds like a pretty good deal, right? Sounds like a buffet to me. Verse 17. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Somebody say that with me. You shall surely die. If I heard that, no fruit is worth it. No fruit is worth dying for. But again, this is how the enemy works. Getting in your mind, get things twisted and turned around in there. And when you don't know God and you're not seeking him the way you should, it's really easy for Satan to deceive you. It's really easy for Satan to twist things in your mind. Why? Because you're not abiding in the light. You're not seeking God. You're not abiding in his light. So if you're being carnal, if you're dwelling in the darkness, man, you're not going to see what's going on. And Satan's going to get you all turned around before you even realize what's going on. Amen? So he says there, dying you shall surely die if you eat of the fruit in the garden. And how many of you know that Eve and Adam did indeed eat of that fruit? Didn't they? Eve took of it, took a bite, gave one to her husband. He took a bite. And now we are where we are. This is why we have murder. This is why we have adultery. This is why we have fornication. This is why we have perversion. This is why we have anything bad. Anything that kills, steals, and destroys in this life, this is why. It goes back to this. Amen? And, you know, you get into big trouble when you think you're so smart that you no longer need God's provision, that you'll find your own. And that's where Eve and Adam got to. They thought they were, you know, they thought they were so smart. They didn't need God's provision because he said you can eat freely of every fruit, of every tree, just not this one, right? They got into big trouble with that. Let's go to Romans 1:21. I want us to look at this here. In Romans 1:21, God wants us to live, and Jesus is the life. Choosing anything other than him will bring death. So here in Romans 1:21, it says, because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Their foolish hearts were darkened. So when you don't know God, that's eternal life, to know him. When you don't know him, when you haven't tasted eternal life, the Bible says here, you're going to become futile in your thoughts, and your foolish hearts will be darkened. Well, what does a foolish heart darkened being look like? Well, let me just give you an example. Black Lives Matter, that's going on today. Which, by the way, there are probably some people who really care about black lives in that organization. Don't get me wrong. But based off what the leaders and founders of that organization have said, I can tell you with surety, they are Marxist. They are not Black Lives Matter. And I'll tell you why. If they truly, again, going back to this, their foolish hearts were darkened, claiming that black lives mattered to them. If black lives mattered so much, you would oppose abortion. Because there are many, many, many more black people being killed by abortions in these clinics that are legalized. Tell you, it ain't legal in the eyes of God. A lot more black people being killed there. All that creativity, all that innovation, all that purpose killed and destroyed. And I'll tell you who's behind it, Satan. He's behind it. You want to know who the racist is? Look at Satan. He's racist against the human race. He don't care what color you are. He'll kill you. That's his desire. And he will pit the human race against each other to try to take us out. And that's exactly what's going on right now. So Black Lives Matter. You got millions of babies being aborted, not a word. You see one white cop shoot a black person, and all hell breaks loose. There's something wrong here with Black Lives Matter. What is this? Foolish hearts being darkened. Foolish hearts being darkened. The only way to create true, lasting change is through the power of the gospel of Christ. Because most people who are claiming superior morality today, most people who are claiming that they care, I'll tell you, they do not care. They're money hungry. They're being used by Satan as divisive tools. Look around you. Is any progress being made around us? No progress is being made around us. Christians, the only progress that can truly be made for the human race is the gospel of Christ being exalted. Nothing else. Nothing else. And too many Christians have fallen to this trap of placing certain organizations and political figures above the gospel. The gospel must be number one in our life. That's what's going to bring life to the world. That's what's going to bring life to society. That's what's going to set people free. You want life? You're not going to get life outside of Jesus, because he is the life. Amen? There is no other way. And if you try to pursue life outside of Christ, you're left with this. Although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Your heart will be darkened. You will be deceived. You will be confused. You will be fighting the wrong fight when you do not know God. Amen. When you are not pursuing life apart, when you are pursuing life apart from Christ, that is what will inevitably happen. It doesn't matter how good your motives are. None of that matters. None of that matters. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We need to get in line with him, to know him. That's how you get aligned with him. That's how you see through things. When people make promises or say things, that's how you see through the junk and the lies and the deceptions, is because you're fellowshipping with God, you're abiding in the light, and you see what's going on. Amen? Thank you, Lord. Praise God. So God's calling us to live in his life. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I want us to go back over to Genesis 3:7. Genesis 3:7. And first of all, I want to mention, we're not going to go back to that scripture, but let me just mention this. In Genesis 2 and verse 17, when it says, "The day you eat of that fruit, you shall surely die." Now, of course, Adam and Eve did not die right when they ate that fruit. But it says, literally, the translation means, "Dying, you shall die." So, the moment they ate of the fruit they were not supposed to eat of, they thought they could be okay apart from God, apart from his provision, okay, apart from knowing him. Death was born, was birthed in their hearts. Dying, they began to die. Death was not a part of God's original plan. We were never meant to die. How many of you know that? Death was not a part of his plan. We were never meant to die. We were never meant to live to 100 or 90 or 70. You were meant to live forever. You are an eternal being. You were created after the image and likeness of God. You were created as an eternal being. Praise God. We can't have this carnal mindset to where we just always see is what's now. No, this is how it was. And we saw the lifespan of people begin to disintegrate over time. Amen. So let's look at this here in Genesis 3:7. It says, "Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings." Made themselves coverings. So again, dying, they shall die. This is right after they had sinned. That's the first thing they did. Their eyes were open. They knew that they were naked. Does that sound like freedom to you? First thing that happened when they sinned, they knew they were naked. That doesn't sound like freedom to me. I'll tell you what happened at that moment. Sin came alive in them, and their flesh began to burn with lust. That's exactly what happened the moment they sinned. Sin became alive in them, and their flesh began to burn with lust. Before this, they didn't know lust. Lust was not in the dictionary. It was not in the vocabulary. There was no such thing as lust before they sinned. There was no such thing as bitterness, no such thing as unrighteous anger, no such thing as laziness. Amen? Why? Because God didn't teach them those things. God didn't teach us to be unrighteously angry. God didn't teach us to be lazy. He didn't teach us to be bitter. Where did we learn that from? We learned that from sin. Sin taught us how to be bitter. Sin taught us how to be angry when we shouldn't be. Amen? That is not life, that is death. And that's exactly what happened here with Adam and Eve. They were dying slowly and painfully. Amen? So Jesus is the truth, the life, and he is the way. Jesus Christ is the way. There's so much more I want to share here. I don't think we're going to get to all of it today. But that's okay. We're going to get a good portion of this. So Jesus Christ is the way. Now, I want us to look at quickly here. We're not going to go through these certain scriptures in Ecclesiastes, but on your own time, Ecclesiastes is not a long book. I believe it's 12 chapters. But there's some very good points and illustrations and you know, messages that King Solomon brings out in the book of Ecclesiastes. So we see that King Solomon in the book of Ecclesiastes, he sought, how many of you know he was the wisest man? He asked God, give me a discerning heart, wisdom. So how many of you know if God gave him wisdom, we should listen to what he has to say? This is wisdom. King Solomon sought many ways to be happy, but they were all vanity, is the conclusion that he came to. These are certain things that King Solomon learned. He learned that wisdom without God will tear your soul apart. He tried to gain all that he could without God, and yet he was none the richer. He learned that you can work yourself to death, but there's always going to be more work, and you'll never be satisfied with what you have. He learned that it's vain to seek popular opinion because the world is always looking for that next big thing or that person to adore and replace you with. These are certain things that King Solomon came to the conclusion in the book of Ecclesiastes. But I'll tell you, so King Solomon, he sought all these different ways apart from Christ. All these different ways. Under the sun, he said, under the sun, all things are vanity. So apart from God, apart from knowing him, apart from eternal life, apart from that relationship with Jesus, King Solomon found out nothing works. Nothing works. You can have all the women, all the men, you know, you can have all the riches, you can have all the popularity. It is all vanity in the end. He found out none of it matters. But here's the one thing that we see in Ecclesiastes that King Solomon did value: friendships. Relationships, friendships. Amen? Praise God. Friendships and relationships. Now I want us to look at James 2:23. James 2:23. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And he was called the what? Come on. What was he called? The friend of God. It's kind of small up there, huh? Maybe that's why you guys, it's kind of small writing up there, but he was called the friend of God. The friend of God. I don't know about you, but to me that's a great honor to be called the friend of God. Why? Because I don't deserve God's friendship. When God is your friend, man, he's loyal, right? He'll back you up with anything. He loves you. He'll never be that friend that you call and he's not there for you. God's always there for you. He's faithful. And you can burn your friend 100 times and God is still there as your friend. Amen? But Abraham was called the friend of God. I'll tell you, this relationship with God, this friendship with God, is more valuable than anything. When you know God, Jesus is the only way. The way to what? When you have that knowing of God, that relationship, that friendship with God, you're going to find out what his ways are. You're going to find out that, man, this is the way to peace. This is the way to power through the Holy Spirit. Not selfish power, not greedy power, true power. That will bless people, that will set people free, that will bring the freedom from myself to them. Why do I have the freedom? Because Christ lives in me. Amen? He'll show you the way to forgiveness. When you can't bear it, when you feel like this pain hurts too much to forgive, I'll tell you, the only way possible to forgiveness, true forgiveness and freedom, it's the way of Jesus Christ. He'll show you the way. When he was hanging on the cross, and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. You think Jesus wasn't hurting? He became sin for us. His soul was being twisted and deformed and being crushed and obliterated by sin. That's what the Bible means, when he became sin for us. Not that he had ever sinned, but he became that so that we could be free. And he still had the strength and the power. How do you know forgiveness is power? Weak people don't forgive. Weak people hold grudges. That's easy to do. But when you meet Jesus, because you're not doing this in your own strength. When you meet Jesus and you begin to discover the way of love and the way of peace and the way of forgiveness and the way of success and the way of prosperity, I'll tell you, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like it. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? Now, I want us to go here. You know, I think we will be able to finish this today. Ephesians 3, and I think we're going to skip a few verses for time's sake. But Ephesians chapter 3, and let's start in verse 17. Let's start in verse 17. It says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height. Again, the depth of God, the width of God, it is, you can't exhaust it. Verse 19, to know the love of Christ. How many of you don't want to know the love of Christ? Which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Filled with all his fullness. What you felt during worship, that's only a taste of what God wants you to experience. It's only a taste. And you can't discover God's love in textbooks, you know. Passes knowledge. The love of God passes knowledge. It's only discernible by the Holy Spirit. You've got to stop closing your heart to the spiritual realm. You've got to stop being closed-minded to the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we ignore him too much, you know. He wants to reveal to you the love of God. And then verse 20, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to be filled with his fullness. To know God is to know his love for you. We cannot. Somebody say, I cannot. We cannot know God apart from a revelation of his love for us. We can't. That's why the Bible says if you claim to know God and you treat your brother or sister like dirt, apart from a revelation of his love for you. It begins and ends at love. Here abide faith, hope, love. The greatest of these is love. Amen? Now I want to ask you this quick question. When Adam and Eve sinned, and it says their eyes were opened, they saw they were naked, they began to sew fig leaves, you know, cover themselves. And you read immediately after that. Let me ask you this. Where was Satan when Adam and Eve sinned? You can go back and read it. Not right now. But, you know, it's interesting how Satan tricked Eve. He said, you know, God's trying to hold something back from you. You won't die. You'll be like God. God's trying to hold something back from you. That's a lie. God is good. He is love. And if you were convinced of his love for you, you would know he's not trying to hold anything back from you. Starts and ends at love. That's what it means to know God. Amen? Now, when they sinned, Satan was nowhere to be found. Left them alone in their nakedness, cold, alone and empty, full of lust. Good. Full of shame. Preach it, sister. Come on. Full of shame. Amen? Satan was nowhere to be found. Where was God? Right after they sinned, right after they sewed those fig leaves and covered themselves up, it says God was walking, trying to find them. God was calling out to them, saying, Adam, where are you? Adam, my son, where are you? I'll tell you, what is this? This is a picture of the depth and the height and the width of the love of God. When you have just messed up, when you have just come to the end of yourself, you are at the bottom of the barrel, when you have messed up so tremendously that you feel like there's no hope for me, there's no future for me, guess who's looking for you? Guess who's calling out your name? It's not Satan. It's God. And you know why? It's for no other reason than because he loves you. That's it. So why do we want to know God? Well, you tell me. Someone who loves me that much when I'm at my worst, I want to know someone like that. I don't want to just know him. I want to become him. Do you understand? I want what God has. Amen. I want what he has. Someone who can love that strongly, I want that in my life. Because what does that look like? That looks like life. That looks like love. That looks like freedom. It looks like truth. It looks like a good way. Amen? A good way to live. Now, I want us to quickly look here at Luke 15. We're about to end it here. Luke 15, verse 20. Again, this is another picture of the Father's love. So we have the youngest son. This is the parable of the lost son. If you haven't read it, you can go to Luke 15 and read it later. Parable of the lost son. The son squanders all of his father's fortune, does sinful, shameful things, waste everything good, and he's none the richer. All of his friends left him. All the ones who used him for his money left him. He's at the bottom of the barrel. You know, he's over here wishing he could eat what the pigs were eating. That's disgusting. Y'all ever seen what a pig eats? I don't want none of that. He was so hungry. He wanted. He just, he wished he could have what the pigs were having. So this is how bad it was. And he finally discovered, you know, my servants have it better than my father's house. I'm going to go back to my father. I had it better over there. And so here he is making his way back to his father's house. Excuse me. Verse 20, and he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Now, I want us to see something here. Excuse me. When this, it doesn't say the son ran to the father. It says when the son was far away, the father saw the son. The father saw the son far away, and the father ran to him. What does this tell you? The father saw the son far away. This tells me this father every day was actively looking for his son. He had no idea where his son was, but every day he would look off as far as he could see in the distance to see if perhaps he would see his son coming home to him. Don't you know this is the heart of the father? God says, I leave the 99 to go after the one. This is God's love, and nothing can top the love of God. This is why we should want to know the Lord. Amen? Now, quickly, here in Ephesians chapter 3, where it says, you don't have to go there, but in Ephesians chapter 3 in verse 19, when it says, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. When you look at the Greek word there for filled, it literally translates to replete. Replete. So, that you may be repleted with the fullness of God. You know what replete means? When you look up the Latin origin of the word replete, it means to fill again. To fill again. This is beautiful about God. He doesn't just want to fill you once. He wants to fill you again and again and again and again and again and again and again. Guess what? When you're at your worst, God wants to fill you again. When you mess up today, God wants to fill you again. When you mess up tomorrow, when you think, well, God's done with me now, guess what he wants to do? Fill you again. Amen. God's not wanting you to live off experiences from 5 years ago. I had a great time, you know, and When I was younger, I met God at youth camp, and I had a great time in his presence, but, you know, I'll tell you, God wants to fill you every day of your life with his fullness. To fill again. How does that happen? Knowing his love. Knowing his love that passes knowledge. That's what it means. This is eternal life, brothers and sisters. To know God, to know his love, and to be filled again and again and again with his fullness. This is eternal life. I want to take us to a few scriptures here in Acts 2:4, and then we'll end it. Acts 2:4. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Acts 4:31. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all what? Filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now I want us to go to John 4:14. But listen, I'm going to read this out of the Passion Translation. This is good too. There's nothing wrong with the New King James Version. But I want us to look at how the Holy Spirit is involved in this. In the Passion Translation, in John 4:14, but if anyone drinks the living water I give them, Jesus says, they will never thirst again and will be forever satisfied. If you're looking for satisfaction. Look, if you want to learn how to pronounce and read, no. If you're looking for satisfaction, look nowhere else than Jesus Christ. You will always, forever be satisfied. For when you drink the water, he says, that I give you, it becomes a gushing fountain of the Holy Spirit, springing up and flooding you with endless life. Amen? Somebody say the Holy Spirit. That's how you know God's love. The Holy Spirit just, man, thank you, Lord, bursting up in you. The Holy Spirit makes you come alive. That Satan can't do that for you. Anything out there in the world, temporary satisfaction. With Jesus, you will be forever satisfied. Why? Because when you drink the water that he gives you, a gushing fountain of the Holy Spirit springs up and floods you with endless life. The love of God, the Holy Spirit, eternal life, knowing him, this is our meaning in life. Amen? Let's go ahead and stand this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Luke 11:13. Let me put this up here. Luke 11:13. We're going to end with this. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Thank you, Lord. The fullness of God. Hallelujah. Father, I pray for people right now here present and they're watching online that have not known your love, have not known your Holy Spirit, have not gotten to fellowship with you to taste your goodness in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, this day would be a turning point in their lives, that they would open up their hearts to your Spirit, open up their hearts to your love, to your goodness, that you may reveal to them your Son, Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you, Lord. You don't want to be the way, the truth, the life. You want to be our way. You want to be our life. You want to be our truth. Thank you, Lord. You want to connect with us on a personal level. And I pray, Lord, this would be a turning point for those who are hearing this word. In Jesus' name, I am encouraging you right now to cast off the weights that are setting you back, that are holding you back, and fully throw yourself at the feet of Jesus right now. You have to do that. Fully throw yourself at his feet that you may taste and see that God is good. I thank you, Lord, that from here on out we are set on a path to know you more, to know what eternal life is, God. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. For those of you who don't know Christ, I'll tell you the Bible says today is the day of salvation. God left the 99 to go after the one. Guess what? If you don't know Jesus, you're the one he's looking for today. You're the one. Amen? I want us to pray this prayer of faith, and I want us to receive the Lord as our Lord and Savior. If you don't know him, whether you're here or watching online, today is the day. Now is the time. God loves you. His grace is there for you to redeem and restore, Nothing you can do can separate you from the love of God. Amen? So I want all of us, let's all pray this together. Say, Father God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace and forgiveness that was purchased for me at the cross. Right now, I repent of my sin. I believe on your Son, Jesus, with all of my heart. And I confess that he is Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's praise the Lord here for a moment. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for all the new births that have just taken place. You are a good God, and this is only the beginning. Amen. So if you're here, I want you to see Sister Sandra. She's got a special book for you if you gave your life to the Lord, and she'll set you up with that book. If you're watching online, comment below or message the church directly, and we'll be able to get this book to you as well, because, again, this is only the beginning for you. You're going to get filled again and again and again and again with the fullness of God, because that is who he is. Amen? Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, we just thank you so much for your love, your grace, your kindness to us, God. We thank you as we go out that we are equipped to be the light of the world. And we thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We love y'all. God bless y'all. Have a great and wonderful rest of the week. And Sister Sandra will be up here in the front if you need prayer.